Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is in session. And if I may, before we start on the regular agenda, we have a special presentation to be made from the governor of the great state of North Carolina. And standing in for the governor is Terry Johnson.
Good evening, commissioners. It's an honor tonight to be standing in for the governor of North Carolina, but it's also a great honor to be able to present this to the individual that's going to get this particular award. And it's one that I've had the opportunity to work with the past 11 years as sheriff of this county. And I'm telling you, commissioners, one thing. I don't believe you'll ever find a replacement to fill those shoes. But at this time, on behalf of the governor of North Carolina, the Honorable Patrick McCrory, I would like to ask Miss Amy Weaver to please come forward. Governor of the state of North Carolina, the Honorable Patrick McCrory, I would like to present to you the Order of the Longleaf Pine. And many people do not realize this, but it is a greater award than a Kentucky colonel or anything else in this nation. And only great people that do great things are awarded this award. And I want to present it to you on behalf of Governor McCrory.
And look who we have here.
I see my whole family.
I'm not
much of a public speaker, but I just want to say thank you to everybody. It has been 30 wonderful years, and I just appreciate everything.
Thank you. I would like to add it's going to be an honor. It's going to be 32 years because she is now under arrest and will be assigned as work release.
I think that's a good idea.
Mr. Chairman, can I add just a couple of things about that?
Yes, sir.
The award itself, the criteria is someone who has given extra effort in their careers and many years of service to their organizations. That's some of the guidelines that are reflected and required. What I wanted to mention was just a couple of the other recipients that are in the same group now as Amy, and they include people like William Friday, Andy Griffith, Michael Jordan, Coretta Scott King, Charles Kuralt, Doug Marlette, Richard Petty, and Oprah Winfrey. So you join a very, very elite group of individuals.
We all should be honored also because when I was county manager, I wanted to name Amy as the finance officer, and she said she just hated to make speeches, and she just couldn't do it. I said, Amy, if I promise you won't have to make any speeches, will you take the job? And she says, all right. So we got a speech from her tonight.
Best decision you ever made.
Yep, it was, absolutely. And we certainly do hate to lose her, I'm telling you.
Mr. Chairman,
I tried to talk her into staying.
If I could say a special thanks to Lash Reichberry, who kind of head up the effort for this and all his efforts. So we appreciate Lash on behalf of the county and on behalf of Amy for this as well.
Thank you, Lash. We appreciate it. Thank you. Now the public comment session. We have five speakers. Luther Allen, please.
Thank you, commissioners. Looks like we keep beating this dead horse. I came here today to pay my taxes. I had my weapon on my hip, and Sheriff Johnson and three other deputies escorted me out. And I was informed at that time that he had talked to the Attorney General of North Carolina, and the North Carolina Attorney General had deemed it that Howard Coble's office was in this building. That's a federal office, and that we could no longer carry our firearm in here. He also said the Attorney General had declared it part of the courthouse, and I don't know how that happened, but if that's the case, then I guess we'll have to go through metal detectors, because if it's a courthouse, you do have to go through a metal detector. So we seem like we keep beating this dead horse, so I thought we had this thing resolved, and apparently not. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Mr. Tony Cox?
How you doing tonight? For a big Christmas, can I get 5 minutes instead of 3 minutes?
3 minutes.
Huh? Can I?
3 minutes.
Well, you know.
We ain't Santa Claus.
Well, you know, I guess I ain't got on the right shoes or something or another. You know, it's amazing. Y'all commissioners come in here and y'all vote in laws, rules, policies along with staff. And y'all commissioners and staff, some, y'all go back to y'all's sanctuary cities and sanctuary counties where y'all don't have to live by the same rules and the same laws that we have to live by. And it has nothing to do with the Sheriff's Department. It's got to do with the enforcement of your ordinances here. Now, we've gone through a mess with these ordinances. Going back to your ordinance, Mr. Smith, 2006, the High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, that was a disaster. The Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance, it's funny on that one, the severability is that the enforcer of the law, the rule, the ordinance, whatever it is, malfeasance, don't matter what you say or do, no accountability. Then the gun ordinance. Again, the same thing. One day we got a rule, one day we got a law, the next day we don't. I just don't, you know, if y'all don't start standing up for us and y'all don't get some sensibility to you, how are we going to do better? How can we possibly do better when we don't have the leadership to do better? If some can break the rules, others think they can break the rules, and it don't matter what it is, y'all stand behind it, it appears. With some are special. We hear about this stuff in all kinds of different places. Here in the last couple of weeks, the North Korean dictator, whatever he is over there, communism, socialism, executed his uncle for corruption in government. If you go after communism, they'll execute you. But in America, you can go after the Constitution and give them a raise. It ain't coming from outside groups, it's inside groups. Take. What are we going to do? If we got these collars on us and you're going to pull it tighter and tighter and tighter, you know, y'all want to live, y'all live how y'all want to. Must be nice. They also mentioned in the Korean deal over there that he was a womanizer, drinking, and drugs. Over there to kill you.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Eddie Boswell, Commissioner Boswell.
Former commissioner.
Always,
good evening.
Always
Merry Christmas to all of you.
Thank you.
I actually come tonight to thank one of the employees here, and I noticed he left, Brian Haygood, for the job that he helped do for the Open Door Clinic. They had called me with a concern because they were being pushed out of the Charles Drew Center, and I just decided I'd come by and talk to Brian real quick, and Brian got on the stick, and between him, Barry Bass, and some of the other employees with the county, they gave them a place to operate out of, and I just want to thank them personally for what they do. And I want to thank Amy for what she did for the 4 years I was here, because she knew what was going on. If anybody had the pulse on what the county was doing, that lady right there did. And congratulations, Amy. You're very deserving of that award.
Thank you.
One other thing that does concern me is the longevity you guys cut for the employees. I don't know. I see you give them a raise, but there are a lot of the very faithful employees that have been here many years, and actually they took a cut in pay, is my understanding, after the longevity was pulled out. So just something to think about. I don't know. I hope y'all have a Merry Christmas. I'm sure a few of them are counting on that money for a Merry Christmas too. So thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Mr. Joe Allen.
Evening.
Hello.
Joe, how are you doing?
Pretty good. I'd like to start off, I'd like to thank you for a job well done last time we seen each other. And I really appreciate y'all done a good job. My dad was coming down to pay his taxes today, and he asked me if I wanted to go. I said, I got to get my little boy off the bus. If you want to wait, though, he could come with us. I'm glad he didn't, because evidently he was forcibly removed from the building by Johnson and a couple of his guys, and I just don't understand, or asked to leave. Asked to leave from the building because he had his firearm. I didn't know we were enforcing the law. I thought we had this put to bed. So I don't know where this law comes. There's no stickers on the door still. But, you know, once again, I'm unarmed. I'm the victim here today. You know, without mine, I'm a victim. Without yours, you're a victim, right? So I don't know what happened. I thought we'd done a good job, and now we backtrack. And I feel let down and betrayed. The citizens of Alamance County will speak their speak when it comes time, but until then, I guess we'll have to lay down like sheep. That ain't right. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Mr. Eddie Shue.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I know I would get, you know, if I was to show up at a Republican Party meeting, having been a lifelong Republican, I'd probably get kicked out because I don't pass every litmus test yet. But let me tell you, here in my park I have cigarettes somewhere. Now, there's been laws and rules passed that I can't come in here and smoke a cigarette. That right is denied me here in the state of tobacco. This is for tobacco. I mean, this in Southern Virginia is tobacco. Of course, the other people grab hold too. But out of concern for other people, they say secondhand smoke kills you too, so I'm not allowed to kill them. I don't really believe it, but maybe it's true. Now, you mark this day down that I'm agreeing with Clive Albright and Terry Johnson. This thing with the gun ordinance is not well thought. Now, I came home Vietnam, I slept in the floor with a gun for 6 months. I couldn't, you know, get over carrying one. But I eventually did, and since then, I have kept guns, but I don't carry them around. The emotional maturity that's required to walk around, I don't even think a lot of law enforcement has. You see these videos of these guys lose their temper. These are officers I'm talking about. You can go on YouTube and see hundreds of them. If the people we hire lose their temper and their judgment, how can you expect people you deny the right with your policies to bring their gun to work? That's county policy, if I'm mistaken. And you say, but the people you have to deal with can bring guns. Now, I'm a Second Amendment man, and I'm conservative. But sometimes, even, you know, a little logic. To have five commissioners vote for this, I would expect some dissension. Yeah, but we didn't get it. But anyway, let's say, mark it down, I agreed with Clyde and Terry, and I didn't ever believe that would happen.
Thank you, Eddie, and thank you for your service, too, Eddie. Any comments from commissioners on any of our speakers?
Well, we're either going to do it now or do it later. We're going to do it before we leave tonight. We need to ask, pull the old Watergate ritual or line of questions. What did you know and when did you know it? I want to know, and we can do it later, but I want to know from about four people, what did they know and when did they know it about the so-called Attorney General's so-called ruling, which I disagree with vehemently, because if you read the state statute, I can reverse it all day long to show that it doesn't hold water. It's not logical. I don't care what you got there. I'm just reading from the state statute. So we can do it. I'd prefer to do it later when we've gone through swordfish and so forth. But I just know the commissioners have been avoided on this issue, and I'm PO'd about it.
That's what bothers me.
I'm very PO'd about it.
If y'all was going to handle it like that, you should have let us know.
Well, I don't care. No, we'll do it now.
Well, we're going to do it later.
All right.
It's all right. I'm sorry, sir. The public comment section's over. Any other commissioner have anything on this item? All right, let's go to the agenda. Is there anything on the agenda any commissioner wants to pull? Hearing none, is there a motion to accept the agenda as written?
To include consent.
To include consent, yes.
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Agenda is approved, including the consent agenda. Now we have a public hearing on refinancing agreement. Is that the county manager?
Yes, sir. In your agenda packet, as part of all the debt refinancing that we could do, we still have one private placement left at $2.1 million. We did bid that out and send out requests for proposals. We received seven proposals back, and the lowest proposal would be for 1.53% as Wells Fargo. And over the life of the loan, that'll save about $123,000. And again, that is lowering the original interest rate that we had from Bank of America from 4.061 to 1.53 with Wells Fargo.
All right, is there a motion we go into a public hearing on this issue?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, we're having a public hearing on the refinancing agreement just explained to all of us by the county manager. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to be heard? If so, please come to the podium. Anyone at all? Anybody on the right, my right side? Anybody on the left side? Any discussion by any of the commissioners? Hearing none. Their motion to go out of public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Second. Been moved and seconded. It. Anybody, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. Is there, what do we need a motion to?
Motion to approve of the financing agreement with Wells Fargo.
Is there a motion?
And the resolution.
And the resolution that is attached.
And, okay.
The financing resolution, yes, sir.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion by commissioners? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The refinancing agreement, et cetera, is passed.
Mr. Chairman, would like to thank Susan Roberts also for all her work in doing the request for proposals and going through the bank bids, and I appreciate that.
Thank you, Susan. EMS report, Dr. Kaminsky. Ah, there you are, Doc. Let me say that Dr. Kaminsky is retiring as our medical director at EMS. He's been with us, what, 7 years?
7 years.
7 years, Doctor? Done an outstanding job and has really been a great asset to the county. He's doing some personal things for a while and will be leaving the country, I think. Is that correct?
That's Doctor? True. That's true. I'm taking my family abroad for a couple of months.
Go ahead, sir.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to address you all today. As Mr. Smith just let you know, I'm Dr. Kaminsky, David Kaminsky. I work at Alamance Regional. I've been there for about 9 years. I've been the medical director for EMS for 7 years. It's been my honor to do that, a real pleasure. I'd like to start with a little bit of an anecdote. I was at Cedar Rock Park this past weekend, 9 days ago, and I was coming home from there along Mount Hermon Rock Creek Road, and up ahead I saw flashing lights and a number of emergency vehicles. Now, of course, as an emergency medicine person, some people dread seeing that, and I got to admit, I get a little excited. Oh, good. I get to see the EMS crews in action, and maybe I can help. It's what I do. And I pulled up, and there was a car had turned back hard left and had been hit, T-bone type of collision at rather high speed. The patient inside the car clearly had a closed head injury, perseverating, repeating questions over and over. And we don't know at that time what other injuries may have happened, but I'm late to the party here. Ambulance, local fire, state troopers are all there. And that's an image that really stood out in my mind. I actually took a picture of it with my cell phone. And what a tremendous resource we have in terms of our EMS and the entire EMS system providing care when we are sick or injured. But while that ambulance was there, they can't be in another location. So I'd like to speak with you about the demands on the system right now and where we stand with some of that. Over the past few years, I've seen the number of calls steadily increase. And the paramedics, the EMTs, working hard, more and more calls per day. We still continue to have our paramedics doing a 24-hour shift most of the time. Some counties have had to back off of that. It gets a little harder for them scheduling-wise, but it's such an intense job for that 24-hour period. The service they provide clearly is outstanding to have medical expertise show up in those situations. We are there on the front lines, just like fire, just like police. But there is one unique attribute, I think, to EMS, which is that we actually are able to generate revenue to offset the cost of the EMS system. So while in 2012, the total budget was just over $6 million, the EMS billing was able to recoup about $4.7 million of that. So yes, the county faces a cost for what EMS provides, but what a bargain, what a deal. And if you go ahead and work the numbers between that 6.1 and 4.7, we're able to recoup 77% of the cost of EMS. Now, as we're facing the EMS system being more and more taxed, 7 ambulances a day we're running, and we're running them hard, we need an 8th ambulance. And that's part of the reason why I'm here today. I'm here to brag about the people who've done the work on the front line and to tell you what else they need, if I could. We've surpassed the limit of what our current staff and resources can provide. We're going on what CECOM would call EMS standby, medic standby. And at that point, there's no ambulance available. We have all our trucks rolling, and that's what we need to help remedy a little bit. On occasion, we're calling for mutual aid from our surrounding counties, but we need an 8th truck. I think that if any of us here called for help 911, the greatest disappointment that we could have for you or your family or neighbors would be for the operator to tell you, we'll get an ambulance to you as quickly as we can, but we currently don't have one available. That's not what people expect. This isn't a luxury. This is something that people expect. Unfortunately, 77% of this is funded by the people who use the system. And I do think that number will get better. That number itself changes depending on how the billing is done. And we've come to a higher percentage in the past. We're doing pretty well right now. I'm not here to tell you the whole thing is free, but it's an awfully good bargain. So thank you for your attention. Any questions, I'll be happy to try to share more with you. There are so many numbers, data points, calls per year I can share with you about our county or the surrounding counties and their budgets that I can provide that for you. But numbers in a conversation like this, I don't want to come right out and just start speaking about numbers for you. So any questions, I'm happy to answer. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions? You go ahead. Dr. Kaminsky, before you leave, the commissioners have a certificate of appreciation for you, and I'd like to read it into the record. Whereas Dr. David Kaminsky has served in the official capacity of EMS Medical Director since April 1, 2006, and whereas as Medical Director, he has had medical oversight of emergency medical services, central communications, EMD program, EMS system plan, and Alamance Community College EMS program. And whereas during his tenure as Medical Director, EMS has implemented several successful programs, including the STEM program in partnership with Duke University Medical Center, and therefore be it resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners express sincere appreciation to Dr. David Kaminsky for his commitment ensuring that medical care standards were delivered uniformly across Alamance County. This is the 16th day of December 2013, signed by all five commissioners.
Very much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Now we have a request to set a public hearing for Project Swordfish. Mr. Charles Bateman from the City of Medlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Commissioners. It's my pleasure tonight to be up here and talk about Project Swordfish. I've talked to you and with you about this project that seems like forever, but actually it's only been the last 15 months. We're excited that the project has chosen Alamance County for its building. It's a massive project, one that we'll be proud of, and offer at a minimum 450 jobs to our community, and an investment that is guaranteed to be at least $85 million. And candidly, we think the number will be much higher than that. It's a conservative estimate. I'm here tonight for two reasons. The first one is probably a little easier to talk to you about, and that's to ask you to set a date of public hearing to approve the actual incentive contract with Walmart, as we all know Swordfish is. The incentive contract itself is lengthy, and I want to thank the county manager and the county attorney their invaluable assistance in the negotiation of that agreement, which will be provided to you for your review prior to the public hearing. The company is most anxious to have all of this concluded in calendar year 2013. Both Mebbin and Graham have unanimously approved the agreement. In fact, we exercised options Friday to buy $4.5 million worth of property. So I guess we're fully committed because we're on the hook now for that. So for that reason as well, we're anxious for you to have a public hearing to show your enthusiasm in sharing in this project. Since they do want it concluded this year, we would ask the commissioners if they would consider setting a special meeting on January 30th, which would allow the county attorney time. Right. I'm sorry, December 30th. Yeah, thank you for correcting me, David. I get lost in my own
oratory. That was a number I heard.
Yeah, I get lost in my own oratory sometimes. And
I understand.
It's hard to catch up. But that's item number one. Item number two is not nearly as pleasant to talk about, and that's the cost and the funding on the project. We initially were given some numbers on water and sewer usage that were considerably higher than what we were guaranteed to receive. And I think the error came about because we were provided only with the peak flows, and we're led to believe that peak flow, we assumed that the peak flow was the daily flow. We're undertaking, and the cities of Graham and Mebbin are fully committed to do this. We're undertaking an extension of water and sewer to the entire Hallfields, I think we call it Alamance and Industrial Interstate Corridor Development Zone, at a cost of about $5.5 million. Initially, with the flows that were anticipated, the funding for that was assured, and we felt good about it. Now the funding from the company is going to be about 20%. In negotiations with the company, they have agreed to guarantee us 40% of what we had anticipated. In other words, they're going to double. They have a take and pay arrangement with us. They'll either take 56,000 gallons a day or they'll pay for it. So that was a big help to us, but it still leaves us several million dollars short of the funding. The cities are committed to it. We have executed and agreed to it, and if we need to and have to, we will find ways to fund it through our ratepayers. What I am hoping to do in the spirit of Christmas, as the earlier gentleman said, is that I can persuade the county commissioners to make this investment in that infrastructure. It is massive. It does carry water and sewer all the way through the entire zone, opening up not only that 1,200 acres, but other areas around it. As you all know, this project and this zone is the linchpin of the county's economic development efforts over the next decade. We think it's got tremendous potential. We think it's an investment worth making. And I have tendered to you, and I think it may be included in your package, a proposed amendment to the industrial interlocal financing agreement that we have in place. And I would ask that you carefully consider that and give it your favorable conclusion. I'll answer any questions you might have.
Any questions? When you talk about the infrastructure, which I am going to support, by the way, I have voted against cash and I'll continue to vote against cash. But when we designate infrastructure, I'm all for that. And finally, there's something I like here. But will this infrastructure of water and sewer, you say it will open up the whole park. So after Walmart, if somebody else comes in 5-10 years later, we won't have to do it. Is that correct?
That's correct. We're hoping it won't be 5 or 10 years
later. No, I hope not either.
A year or two later.
Good. Well, I support infrastructure.
It's a great project, and you know, the state's committing over $2 million to put the roadway into us. And it's
a win-win situation.
It is a win-win, Mr. Black. Any other questions?
Charles, are you asking our answer on the $1 million now or at the public hearing?
I'm really asking for both, but I can live without. I really need the public hearing the worst, but I'd love to have a positive answer on both of them. It's possible. If not, if you'd rather consider it for the next meeting, I'm okay with that, too.
It's a pleasure of the board.
Well, I think we need to have a public hearing before we have the vote. That's my personal opinion, even though I support it.
On the $1 million increase.
Mm-hmm. I do have a question for either Craig or Charles. With this additional commitment, every time we talked around this, hypothetically, we've been looking at how the return would be. How does the money come back over time from Walmart?
It'll be about 13 years.
For
when we look at land, when we look at the additional $1 million that would be putting in, it would be a 13-year payback.
From additional tax revenue that they would pay once the structure is complete?
Right.
And that's based on their minimum guarantee.
Right.
On their minimum guarantee without anything else. I think that the Graham public hearing, Walmart people were there. They were at our meeting as well. They'll be at your meeting as well. They anticipate an expansion sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
It will almost add significantly to the total taxation. Of course, we've already started getting talk to some other people about pursuing expansion plans in the zone. So we think it's what we look at it is not so much the return of our money on this project, but the return of our total investment to be able to open up an industrial park, including the roads, water, and sewer. And to say I'm guaranteed that I'm going to have that money returned to me in 13 years, I think most bankers would probably say, I'll put some money on that.
And then my other question for Craig is, do you have a proposed date in mind for the public hearing? This is our last scheduled meeting.
We would need to look at a special call meeting on December 30th.
And that's a Monday?
Monday.
Yes, it is.
2 weeks from today.
Yes, sir.
Anybody have a conflict?
We could do it in the morning if the board so chose.
9 a.m. on the 30th?
Tim?
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Charles.
Thank you, Mr.
Mr. Chairman, you need a motion to that effect and to have the vote at that time, or
we're
just
so.
Doing
let's do it.
I'll make that motion that we set the public hearing date for 9 o'clock 2 weeks from today, and at that time we'll consider the vote for the additional $1 million commitment.
Thank you, Tom. Any second to
that? I second it.
Any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. All right, next we Family Justice Center, Judge Robertson.
Mr. Judge,
good news, right, Judge?
It is good news.
Yay.
Hopefully not controversial news.
So oh, come on.
I'm not. It's a, Mr. Chairman and Board Commissioners, it's my pleasure again and privilege to be before you on behalf of the Family Justice Center, our county's Family Justice Center. Just one little thing before I get started with what the particular request is that we are still receiving inquiries from other counties, including Wake County, Guilford County, to look at this county's Family Justice Center as the way to do business and the way to protect those who are the most vulnerable in our community, or some of the most vulnerable. So I always want to do a little shout out for the commitment that you made. It's still paying dividends. It's like infrastructure.
No cash.
No cash. All infrastructure. What I'm here for today on behalf of the Family Justice Center Advisory Board, and I believe in your package you have a resolution of support, and it's signed by a number of folks. We're talking about essentially every chief of police and the Chief Deputy Britt on behalf of the Sheriff's Department. And a number of others, Department of Social Services, a large group of folks who are supportive of the Family Justice Center and meet monthly to try to make sure it's the best we can have. And they're in support of these two requests. The first one is a renewal grant for what we call our Court Navigator Program. This is one that you already approved about 2 years ago to give us our first start. It's been amazingly successful. The Court Navigator Program is a program that's designed to recruit volunteers to assist victims of domestic violence as they try to navigate through the court system. Now, I've been practicing law or a judge for upwards of getting close to 39 years, and when I go to another county, I experience some anxiety trying to figure out the lay of the land and that sort of thing. So I can imagine what unrepresented folks would experience as they try to go through our court system here in the county. The benefit of it is that we used to have a dismissal rate of about 50% of our domestic violence cases, a large number because folks gave up and were nervous and just didn't show up. Using the Navigator program, we've had about a 20% decrease in those dismissals. The benefit of that is not every case is going to end up in a protective order, but at least the court gets an opportunity to rule on the merits of the case and not someone being afraid because of the process. The amount that's involved, the proposed budget is $190,000 over the 2 years. I believe this starts at the June 30 would be the end of the first 2 years. 38,000 of that would be in-kind match, which we can meet in spades because we have currently 31 volunteers, people in the community who volunteer, and that's in-kind match. So the in-kind match is not a problem on that. These funds will come through the Governor's Crime Commission. That means some place in North Carolina is going to get these funds, and we'd like for it to be Alamance County. And so that is my initial request, is for your approval for the Family Justice Center to apply for renewal of the Court Navigator funds. Now, I don't know if you want me to take these, Mr. Chairman, one at a time, or
well, let's see if we can get it passed for you, Jeff.
There, okay.
Do we have a motion?
So move.
Second.
Second.
All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, Judge.
Thank you very much. The second one is, this is a new money request. But the funds also come through the Governor's Crime Commission, so these are, again, funds that are going to go somewhere in North Carolina. what we experience a lot of times in domestic violence court is, deals with custody issues. It's really because a lot of times the children experience the domestic violence. Sometimes the children are witnesses to the domestic violence. Sometimes the parents just can't get along, and we know they're going to have the children with them at some point. And so we're required by the legislature to address custody issues at domestic violence hearings. That's a requirement. What happens is that lay people don't generally do a very good job of getting that issue before us and in an understandable fashion, and it does help to have attorneys involved. But a lot of folks just don't have the funds for an attorney. Legal aid represents a number of folks, but they have budget limitations pretty severe. And so there's a group that is not generally represented. And that means that we may enter orders that just aren't broad enough to cover what we do in sort of custody matters involving domestic violence and potential for danger to the children. That's kind of the limited scope of this. It again is supported by the entire Family Justice Center Advisory Committee. The budget on that one is $150,000 for 2 years, or the funding amount, but 30 of that is by in-kind match. And the way this is designed to operate is that a certain attorney, sort of like our court-appointed list, Judge Smith, of there are certain attorneys who would do it at a reduced rate, would volunteer or put their services forth at a reduced rate, and when that budget's over, that money's gone, but it would help folks during that period of time that the money's available. The way to meet the in-kind match is that reduced rate is substantially below the fair market rate, and that difference makes up the in-kind match. These funds, as I indicated, would be new dollars. We'll have to deal with the sustainability aspect. That may require actually money from the General Assembly or something like that if we get to that point. What I'm really hoping that you will consider favorably is allowing us to at least have the use and benefit of this money for a period of time and try to demonstrate to the General Assembly that it might be a useful and beneficial program, and do some sort of cost-benefit analysis like that.
Are these state funds also?
These are, the Governor's Crime Commission is the conduit for federal funds. Okay. So they come in to the Governor's Crime Commission and then to North Carolina. And so that commission will dole them out and allot them to recipients all across the state of North Carolina. And in each state, there's something like the Governor's Crime Commission, something like that conduit. Ours just happens to be called the Governor's Crime Commission.
Any questions for Judge Robinson? Mm-hmm. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye.
And besides, Merry Christmas. Thank you again for that Family Justice Center.
Judge, thank you for your leadership on this. Really do appreciate it. Let's hear from our library. MJ, you want to come forth and tell us about the library system?
Mr. Chairman, other county commissioners, I get to spotlight the library today, which I always like to do because I like talking about libraries. So I'm here to represent the Alamance County Public Libraries. And our mission is to provide free and open access for lifelong learning, to provide resources for everyday living and reading for pleasure in a welcoming environment. Our collections, our services, and programs enhance the quality of life for individuals, families, and communities. And I'm not going to read all these to you. I'll start off with our materials budget. For books and AV, this past year, you all voted to award us $130,000. 130, is that, I get my commas wrong, but but it's $130,000 to be spent on books and e-books. We were awarded $50,000 to spend on audio visuals, which is books on CD, playaways, which are these really cool little MP3 players that have the books preloaded on them so that you don't have to download them yourselves, you don't have to change CDs, things like that. Music CDs and DVDs. And then $16,500 is spent on periodicals. Our additional resources are from a community development block grant for North Park, and this year we were awarded $26,000 rather than the $10,000 that we are usually awarded. And all of that is spent on materials for the whole system. They're housed in North Park, but all of the materials that we purchase are shared between all of the branches and go from branch to branch. In terms of the e-books, I'd like to say that this past year we purchased 843 e-books, but we have access to 28,215 through a consortium statewide called NC Live. So all the counties in the state purchase e-books, they go into this consortium, and everybody has access to them. We have three big branches, we call them the big three. We have May Memorial, Graham, and Mebane Public Library, and they're open 7 days a week during the winter. Mebane and Graham close on Sundays during the summer. And May is open until 9, Monday through Thursday. We went through this earlier, and you all very graciously awarded us two additional, the 75 additional staffing hours, so we were able to keep the hours at May Memorial. So we're very pleased about that, and thank you very much for that. And then we have two smaller branches, North Park Library, which is at the Mako Bigelow Center in northern Burlington, and Snow Camp, which is out, or South Annex, which is down in Snow Camp, and it's a heavily used branch. It's only open for 5 hours on Wednesday afternoon, one day a week, and families are always out there. It's used more than North Park. The past year, 592,433 people visited these five libraries. Wow. So people come and use our libraries. These five libraries are staffed by 29 full-time employees, and that includes 10 professional positions, 10 people that have a master's in library science, so they went to graduate school, and one non-professional position who's full-time did the additional study and got a library support certification. I forget what the second C stands for, but she's one of five people in the state of North Carolina and one of 40 some people in the country that actually pursued this additional certification. So it's a real honor for us to have her on our staff, and she's still taking, you know, classes to do her job better. And we then also have 26 part-time employees, and this includes two couriers and seven shelvers. The two couriers work 6 days a week to take materials back and forth between all of the branches, because if somebody in Mebane wants a book that's at May, we've got to have a way to get it there. And so we have couriers that work Monday through Saturdays to haul things back and forth to each other. And so we've pull holds in the morning. We get phone calls and people place holds on their computer. We pull them all in the morning, get them ready to go to the different branches, and the couriers deliver them for us. The services that we provide are quite a broad spectrum. We provide materials for checkout, and last year, and this is the fiscal year 2012-2013, we circulated 816,494 items, and this included books, DVDs, CDs, magazines, all of our materials. We were asked 49,379 reference questions last year. And a lot of those included searches for genealogy and ancestry. We helped a grandson find information about his grandfather who was killed in World War II. It includes ready reference, which we evidently have people that will call and ask us for directions or phone numbers or hours of different places or how to spell a word or what's the definition. We have a patron who calls May Memorial often. I think he and his friends do some betting, and they will ask us questions like, how many Three Stooges were there total? And there were four. Who was the drummer of Led Zeppelin? Who won the 1987 World Series? Things like this. And Aaron says that you can always hear him when he's getting ready to hang up and saying, see, you owe me $10. And it's always early in the morning right when we open. So there's this one guy that he and his friends are evidently trying to get this esoteric information. And then we also have complex reference questions. My reference staff helped someone find out information about the dogwood tree that was planted in front of the post office on Maple Avenue. Evidently, the 4-H group that planted it back in the early 60s got soil from all over the world to plant this tree. And somebody called asking it for information about it, and they were able to locate the newspaper article from the 1960s that talked about the planting of the dogwood and all the different countries that the soils came from and how the 4-H group put it together. So I think reference has the most interesting job. They get a lot of interesting questions. We also offer online resources. We pay for subscriptions to Ancestry.com that helps in the genealogy research that a lot of folks do. We pay for the newspaper archive database, so we have access to old newspapers from all over the country. And then we, because we're a public library, we're part of the NC Live Consortium that offers us access to things like consumer reports, the e-books, just a broad spectrum. Had a study for different certifications, your electrical licensing, all kinds of things. It's a huge help. And we offer computers and wireless. Last year we had 135,462 people using our public computers. We don't have a way to measure how many people are using our wireless at this point, because we don't, the system doesn't keep those numbers for us. We try to extrapolate it, but it's purely subjective how we do that. And in fact, North Carolina report that I have to send in has said unless we have a program that measures it, not to even bother counting that. So the questions that we get include printing, scanning, job application help, because more and more jobs are online. If you want to go work for Food Lion or Lowe's or McDonald's, you've got to fill out the application online. And often these are people that don't have access to computers or know how to use computers. You have to have an email. And so my staff helps them set up all this information and helps them navigate the computers to do job applications. We teach computer classes and teach people how to use the Microsoft Office suite. This is how many people we think used our wireless last fiscal year. Again, we would just, during Statistics Week, walk around the library and count how many people were using it, and then we'd sort of multiply that by the number of hours we're open and pull it out that way. But it's not a fast, firm number. We also, as one of our services, offered the Sorenson video phone for the hearing impaired, so that if you are deaf, are hearing impaired and need to make a phone call, how do you do that? So we got the Sorenson phone that has a video with it, and the person signs what their needs are, and the person on the other end is hearing and can read sign, and then translate that to the person that the hearing impaired person is trying to talk to, and vice versa. So that's a service that I don't think many public libraries offer, but is actually well used for us. We offer meeting rooms to the public, to nonprofits, and our meeting rooms were used by 4,223 people last year. They stay pretty heavily booked. And we offer interlibrary loans to other patrons in other counties, other states, actually, and then they also, in turn, ask for us to borrow materials from us through this interlibrary loan, and we loaned over 700 items were loaned or borrowed last year. I mentioned computer classes. We have a mobile laptop lab that we bought through a library services and technology grant, and it allows us to teach computer classics. So we teach some basics, the introduction to the internet, how to set up and use an email account, the Microsoft Offices, Word, Excel, PowerPoint Publisher. And we also teach classes that are an introduction to social media like Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest. And we also use the computer lab to the mobile laptop lab to teach job application and resume help. And we're in talks, for instance, with Allied Churches to take the mobile laptop lab there and teach some basic computer skills, help fill out job applications and things like this. So we're to the point now where we're ready to take that mobile laptop lab out into the community. We'd like to take it to the mall and set up for people that need to fill out the Affordable Care Act forms or the job help and help them write resumes, things like this. So our classes, we're trying to really look at what the needs of the community are and focus our classes around those needs, because contrary to popular belief, not everybody has computers. Nobody, if you have to decide between medicine and food or internet access, more than likely food and medicine are going to win out. So the libraries are the place that the people that don't have money can come and have access to these resources. We do a ton of programs, and I'll break it down by adult programs and young adult and children's programs. Last year, we did 230 adult programs, and 3,226 people came to those. These included author visits. We had Jeffrey Deaver in the past. This past year, we had Margaret Maron, who writes the great mysteries about the Judge Deborah Knott. So we have different authors come and visit us. We do crafts. We have a Pinterest group that comes and does crafts. We do programs of personal interest. We have knitting groups. We had someone come and do a home brewing program this past year. We have writing workshops. We taught Jitterbug. We had ghost hunters come and see if May Memorial was haunted. It is. We are having a UFO program coming up in January. So whatever, just some fun interests that are going on in the community, we're going to have programs for. We did a lot of couponing programs, raising chickens. So just a lot of different personal interest ones. And we have exercise classes. We are partnering with the YMCA at Graham Library to teach Zumba and yoga. So we have also, we do special events. We do Alamance Reads, which we came and took your pictures last year for that. We have an amazing mystery night that is so popular now we have to do it over two nights because tickets are gone by the end of the first week, and so we have done it over two nights now. And this past November, we did a program called Our Veterans Speak, where we had veterans from the different wars come and talk about their experiences. We have had some classes to educate on the Affordable Care Act, because there's so much confusion on how that's going to play out, and the public, you know, our job is to educate or to help educate, and so that's one of the programs that we, way that we're helping to educate the community. We've partnered with 67 agencies in the past year on programs, and that includes museums, the art center, daycares, the school system, the YMCA, and tons of other ones. The teen programs are always fun. Last year we had 111 programs and 1,396 people attended them. We had Teen Read Week, where we had a nationally known author named Elliot Schrieffer. He was nominated for the book, the National Book Award. And during Teen Read Week, we had over 800 people attend the programs that week. We took him out to the school system, and he did two programs there. We had crafts. We had a whole variety of programs. But that was a real popular program. We do crafts. We play video games to get the kids into the libraries. We have a Wii and an Xbox, and we'll have competitions going on. We show, we have an anime club. This is a picture from their cosplay where they dress up as their favorite anime character, and they read anime books and talk about the different anime characters in the books. And we have special events. This past October, we had a zombie promageddon. And all the kids came dressed as zombies and learned how to do makeup, and we had disgusting looking food that was supposed to look like fingers and brains and, you know, all this stuff. But the kids, we had kids that never come to the library come to that and have since come back. I've seen them at other programs. So, you know, even though it may not be my thing to have zombies all over the place, it got the kids in. So that's what we're all about. One of the teen programs that we do yearly is we work with the school system to do What's After High School, where we talk about, you know, what options are out there for the high school kids when they get out of school. Children's programs, last year we had 1,164 programs that 789 people attended, and these included story times for babies, for preschools, for toddlers. It included book clubs. We have awesome readers, book buddies, the jumping genres. We have a lot of book clubs for the kids. We have Pause for Reading. And I had a parent tell me that their son was reading below reading level, about 3 degrees below their reading level, and they started bringing him to read to a dog. Now, when you read to a dog, the dog's not going to correct you. The dog's not going to make faces at you. He's just going to sit there and just love the attention. And the kids get comfortable reading. And this child brought his reading level not only up to his reading level, but above it. And they still continue to come to our Pause for Reading. And we use certified therapy dogs for that. We offer Lego time every Sunday at May Memorial and at other various times in the other branches. And we have partnered with Home Depot to do building workshops at the libraries, and they are packed. The kids love them. And Home Depot brings in all the tools, so come to the library, we're hammering and sawing. Well, I don't know if we're sawing, but we're hammering and painting and doing all kinds of stuff. And that's been a great partnership for us. And we have special events like summer reading programs. Studies show that if you kids keep reading during the summer, it helps them maintain their reading levels. And so we try to engage the families and the children through our summer reading programs, and those are wildly popular. Our libraries during the summers are hopping. This past year we had Big Bang Boom kick off our summer reading program. And Bright Star Touring Theater often comes as part of our summer reading program, but we also just had them out for to do a Dickens Christmas Story. And who knew that Dickens Christmas Story could be told to small children by two people, and they did an excellent job of presenting the whole story and the whole ideas in all of that. We work with Head Start to bring story times to North Park. To daycares that don't often have access to resources and materials. So our goal is not only to educate the public, to offer them resources both for lifelong learning and for pleasure, but we are, as Keith Richards says, a great equalizer. We're the place that you go if you can't afford computers, you can't afford to rent DVDs, you can't afford to buy books or buy an e-reader. Everybody was worried about that e-books were going to replace books. They're not, because there are so many people that are still trying to just buy groceries and are not going to be able to afford e-readers and e-books. It's just another format. So I loved this quote by Keith Richards: when you're growing up, there are two institutional places that affect you most powerfully, the church, which belongs to God, and the public library, which belongs to you. The public library is a great equalizer, and that's what we see our role in the community as being. Do you have any questions?
Well, you know how much I love the library, so I hope you won't take this as being combative, but how many Three Stooges did you say there were?
There were a total of four, actually, not all at one time, and I could not name them, I'm sure.
Well, now, my research shows that from 30 to 69, there were six.
Ah.
Mo and Larry the whole time, then you had Shemp, Curly, Joe, and Curly Joe.
Oh, well, I'll have to talk to my reference folks about it.
Never thought I'd bring that out of the county.
Exactly.
Now we know what you're
doing. MJ, you had anniversary earlier this year.
May Memorial celebrated its 75th anniversary this year. Wow. And a lot of the May family came down from Connecticut and all over the place, and it was wonderful, and they're such a good family to work with and talk to. And it's interesting because so many of them have ended up being librarians. There's some school librarians and public libraries.
But your history on the downtown and the old post office, and that was, I know you had some notes, but that was very well versed, your background.
As part of that, Walter Boyd put together all the history with May Memorial, and it started off because the post office just wouldn't settle down anywhere. I mean, every other year they were saying, well, no, let's put the post office over here, let's put the post office over here, and somebody finally decided on a firm, fast and firm place for the post office, they thought, and they built this grand building. And then, of course, a couple of years later, oh no, let's move the post office. And so I think the Mays somehow or another ended up going and saying, you know, we'll buy the post office if you will help us raise them, you know, we'll pay half of it if you'll pay the other half. And so that's sort of how May Memorial, and that's a very abbreviated version of how May Memorial came about.
Well, and the other thing I'll comment on, I spoke to the Alamance leadership class, I don't know, a month ago, mm-hmm. and one of your people attended that, pointed out the wonderful partnerships that the county library has with the cities and towns who provide the facilities.
The public libraries are done, they're interesting. The municipalities are responsible for maintaining the buildings. So they handle all the utilities, all of the repair, if we need new carpet, or there's a hole in the wall, or we've got leaks, you know, from the commodes or whatever, they handle all of that. And then the county handles the resources, the staffing, the purchase of materials, the, you know, paying the contracts to keep us up and running, this type of thing. So it really is a partnership between the municipalities and the county.
And I guess it was somebody from the city of Burlington that pointed that out.
Probably. Yeah, I think Peggy, because she's the finance person. Right. She's in Leadership Alliance with me. Right.
Right. Any other questions or comments?
Questions?
Thank you very much, MJ.
Thanks, MJ.
Grant application for recreation and parks. Who's going to take the over there, Brian?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, before I get started talking about this grant opportunity, I want to let you know, if you remember, about a year and a half ago, came to this board with the opportunity to buy approximately 78 acres adjacent to Cedar Rock Park. This property came up for sale, and we were made aware of it, and we're very interested in adding it to the park. Came to the board. The board was in agreement that we should do everything we can to secure that property via funds from outside. I'm pleased to report tonight that we've received the final contract from our last grant that we applied for, and it looks like we'll be able to acquire that property for $490,000, all with funds from outside the county, which was our goal.
It's a lot of hard work by staff and groups from around the county like Pine Ridge Church and Friends of Cedar Rock Parks. A lot of hard work put into it, but we're very pleased to be able to report that, and I look forward to working on closing that property. So, this evening, what I'm here to ask you to consider is our department is interested in applying for a grant for $80,000 from the North Carolina Recreational Trail Program grant. This would be to do very limited development on this property adjacent to the park. We would use it to install a new hiking trail that would be compliant to ADA law, where people with wheelchairs or limited mobility could use that trail, as well as two parking areas on the new property, one for this new hiking trail, and then one of the proposed developments for the property is to expand our horse trail from existing Cedar Rock Park out into this part of the property. And we would use the funds to also establish a new horse trailer parking lot. As you can imagine, they need a pretty big area to park their rigs. Total grant is $80,000. There is a match required of 25%. And what we're proposing to do is our staff will use our own equipment, our own folks as labor, which we value at $5,000. And then the department has money in a designated fund for the future development of Cedar Rock Park. These are not tax dollars or county general funds. These are funds that have been donated to the park or raised through fundraisers. We would recommend using $15,000 of that money. So again, this is not general fund money. This will be in-kind labor as well as donated funds and funds from that were created through fundraisers. This project has been reviewed by the Recreation Parks Commission, and they have recommended that you approve our ability to apply for the grant. So I'm here tonight to recommend that to you and see if you have any questions for me.
Any questions? Motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Manager, appointment of interim finance officer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As the board is aware, with the upcoming retirement of Amy Weaver as of December 31st, we won't have our new finance officer's position appointed by that time, and we would need to appoint someone to be the interim, and the recommendation to the board is to appoint Susan Roberts as the interim finance officer beginning January 1 until that position is filled.
I think that's a good idea.
Any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Do want to say that does put in the recommendation with a 10% salary increase during the time that she is serving as interim.
Any objection to that?
Nope.
Good luck. County manager's report.
I do have a couple of things. One of the things that we need to look at is setting a couple of dates or a day to look at interviews for the finance officer's position. As the board's aware, you gave us names and we have come up with a list of five. We can do that in one day, we can do it 2 days, is whatever time you would like to. If you would just give me a couple options, and then we can call those candidates, let them be aware of the time and the day, and bring them in and begin that process.
Where are the five from? North Carolina, I mean.
There is one that is out of state. The thought process would be to try to do a video conference with that person instead of flying that person in.
What's the pleasure of the board?
I say let's do it.
Yep. You want to do them all in one day?
I'd like to see them all in one day. If we can, no problem for whatever we do.
Greg, do you have a proposed date?
No, sir. We're as flexible.
We're ready, aren't we? I mean, we're ready.
We just need a date to get with the candidates and let them know. So we're as flexible as Gumby.
Mr. Chairman, I just suggest that Tori work this out individually rather than talk about individual calendars in front of this.
All in favor of that?
just a question. You want to try to do it after the first of the year?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. What right. You think?
Yeah.
After the first. Good luck, Tori.
thank you. Just a couple of dates to remember. This Thursday, December 19th, is the employee Christmas luncheon, which we do have scheduled at Graham Rec, and that will be from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Would love to have you come. And also just a reminder that our offices will be closed next week, the 24th, 25th, and 26th. And the next meeting of the Board of Commissioners will be January 17th, which will be a night meeting.
That's the next scheduled meeting. We have one on the 30th.
December
3rd. Oh, it's December 3rd. I'm sorry, regularly scheduled. I'm sorry.
Regularly scheduled.
It's the 21st. Okay. Oh, yeah, 21st.
Yeah, Craig, would you repeat that? You said
I'm
the 7th.
Sorry. It is the 21st.
Yeah. Which is what
I have it written
been handed out. This is
yes.
Correct.
Yes, I have it written down the 21st. That's the reason why.
That's a Tuesday evening.
Yeah, because of Martin Luther King Day on the 20th.
Okay. Anything else, Craig?
No, sir.
All right. Commissioner's comment, Tim?
Yeah, is Jerry Makins here?
He was asked to be here, said he would be here.
Yeah, I see in the back.
Yep.
Yeah, if you'll come on in. I appreciate the opportunity to be able to do this before we go into closed session. You don't need to. You just have a seat there.
Are we going into closed
session? Or maybe we're not.
I don't see it on here.
Okay.
It's not on here.
Is it on there?
No.
Okay, good.
When
we had the issue come up about the ordinance, about a resolution about the concealed carry and open carry, Attorney Albright stood there and gave us his opinion, but never did make a statement at all that he felt like it was illegal, that we were violating any statutes or laws that hadn't been changed in Raleigh. So we voted 5-0. We create an ordinance. Is that not correct? We
didn't create anything.
What did we do?
You did not consider the ordinance.
Okay. The 5-0, though, to knock down the concealed carry was a repealing.
Right.
But no one made a motion to consider the ordinance.
So I understand that, but I'm talking about concealed carry, where we had a 1995, and then we repealed it,
which made
it legal.
Right.
Is that not correct?
Then you repealed it, and it's gone.
Okay, so we made it legal. And so after that, well, you know, we all assume it's overdone with. Okay, well then, in passing, I speak to the county manager the next day or so, and I asked him, had he heard anything about it? He said, well, you know, we might have a problem with it because of Janine's office downstairs, the federal scenario, possibly. And I'm not going to fib to you. I thought, well, here we go again. I felt like there was a backdoor effort after the fact to shoot it down. I mean, if there was a concern about that, we should have heard about it right there. And we didn't. Then I pick up the Alamance News, and I see a response that that our county attorney is replying that, well, he assumed that we knew it was improper. That's the way I read it, that he assumed that he had shown us where there were laws that would prohibit it due to her office being in our building, and that he assumed because we didn't ask any questions that we would know that it was improper. That's the way I read it. Okay. Well, what I was shown, in my opinion, was a bunch of legalese and so forth and so on. That's what I feel like we have a county attorney for, to put it in lay terms where lay people can understand it. And I don't think we got that. The law, as I see it right here, is permit to carry concealed handgun scope of permit. It says here, a permit does not authorize a person to carry a concealed handgun in any of the following. And then it lists several things. You come down to item number 6, it says, in a building housing only state or federal offices. Well, that's not her situation. And then you go down to number 7, it says, in an office of the state or federal government that is not located in a building exclusively occupied by the state or federal government. And I don't think she that qualifies. You know, I don't see what the Attorney General could have ruled against, frankly. Not if you look at those two items here. Now, I do want to hear what we found out about it. But I want to know the chain of who told who to do what to investigate this, especially without telling the county commissioners. I got a phone call today from Luke that this had taken place. And I was just stunned that I've got a county attorney that hadn't advised me of this. I've got a county manager that hasn't advised me of this. I've got Jeremy Akins in tax that hasn't advised us that this was going to be the analysis. And the sheriff. We've got four people here. And I haven't heard a word. And I'm going down the interstate, and I get a phone call hours before this meeting that, you know, what we did was improper. Now, I'd like for somebody to tell me, at what point did somebody tell you that you were to call? Did you make a phone call that Luke was in the office today?
No, sir.
Okay, who made the phone call?
I don't know that we did.
Do you know that y'all didn't?
We contacted Robin and Legal and informed him that, informed her that he was in paying his taxes.
Robin's in what, Klein's office?
That's right.
Okay.
And the only thing that we were told is that we'd need him to wait. Anytime that someone comes in, there's a certain situation where we need to contact Robin and let her deal with him. And while he was waiting, it was resolved. That's all I know. I mean, as far as our office, the only communication we had was with Robin.
I'm talking about who called to get the sheriff's department involved in this. Somebody had to make a phone call.
Not my office.
Nobody in your office.
Now, as far as I'm aware, once we contacted Robin, you know, she may have contacted someone. I don't know. But what I have knowledge of is we contacted Robin. That's the only contact.
And you were contacting her over a tax matter rather than the gun issue.
Sure.
Right. So
that's
you
right.
You say that nobody in your tax office that you're aware of called Sheriff's Department.
Okay. Not to my knowledge.
Okay. Mr. Attorney, did somebody in your office call the Sheriff's Department?
I've been hunting the sheriff all day on some things we're doing in the federal case. And I talked to, I think it was Shelton.
Shelton Bryan.
And during my phone conversation with Shelton, my paralegal came in and said Mr. Allen was downstairs. And I told Shelton, well, Mr. Allen's downstairs. And he said, Allen, the guy with the gun? I said, yeah. Have the sheriff call me, because I wanted to get him to talk to the sheriff of Wake County. We're working on some things in our federal case. We've got about 14 of these declarations to do. He's been running all over the place trying to get them done. And that's how that happened.
Well, at what point was the Attorney General's office brought into this?
That was done a couple weeks ago.
On whose initiative?
By our initiative, because we were told that it was by the state and federal statute violation of law. And I immediately, once we got Attorney General's ruling, contacted Mr. Smith, and I think I told Bill Lashley, and I told what the Attorney General told us to the county attorney.
Where does it say it's illegal? Would you read it to us?
Yes, sir. It says, of course, there's a whole bunch of stuff here, but it says, an office of the state or federal government that is not located in a building exclusively occupied by the state or federal government, it is illegal to carry a firearm into that building.
I can see where that could be understood.
Mm-hmm. And because like you, we wanted to make sure before anything was done, the Attorney General's office was contacted by Chief Deputy Britt, and he said, absolutely not. That's the interpretation.
It says in an office of. You're not in her office when you're coming through the corridor going to the elevator.
The Attorney General's office, it didn't matter.
Is it verbal? Do you have his ruling as verbal, or do you have it written?
I think Chief Britt is not. He's on a hunting trip right now, but I think he has it written.
Written. Mm-hmm.
And I say I have not laid eyes on it, because like Clyde said, we've been working. I've been running all over the place getting depositions or declarations in our case. But Chief Britt handled this. And when he came to me, I immediately contacted David Smith and told him we may have a problem.
Well, I've heard that we may have a problem, but we weren't told that it was fine.
Well,
at least,
I did.
we were told that it was finite, that this was going to be the rule. This was going to be, and in my opinion, you got a law that could be challenged by us versus the state or the interpretation of these laws. I would say to you that her office is her office, not the hallway, nor the receptionist, nor the tax, nor coming upstairs.
Well, now, when you come upstairs, the attorney general says it's a problem too, because we have a courtroom right here. And people come up, bypass the metal detector, and come straight through here to the courtroom. And these are just some of the things that pointed out. And I'll be honest with you, when the attorney general gave us his ruling, I'm sworn and I intend to enforce the law.
Well, we haven't seen the ruling. Wouldn't you think that the county commissioner should see the ruling?
Well, sir, I was told that the law was given to y'all.
It was not.
I received it.
I sent a four-page memorandum of law to each of you.
I saw his memorandum.
26th of November, talked about federal preemption, state preemption, and listed the 10 areas where you cannot have a fire.
No, I saw it, but there's so much ambiguous stuff there and hair splitting. I've never seen anything beat it.
That's like why we call the attorney general.
Well, you can make a phone call to him. I still haven't seen the ruling. I still have not seen it.
Well, what I was doing is telling you that he had sent the stuff to y'all, and I was told that y'all had it in your package.
Did you make the inquiry, or did the sheriff's department make the inquiry?
I don't inquire to the attorney general unless this board asks me to.
Well, that should have been the chain of command.
And I thought the law was clear in that memorandum. I cited some cases and the 10 places where you cannot have a firearm. And the fact that the state law preempts any county or city ordinance.
Let me see if I can clarify this. I think the county has done everything that we can do. We repealed the ordinance that was on the books about carrying a weapon in our buildings. That's all we can do. The only authority and power we have is what the legislature gives us. We can't just go out and make up anything. State law and federal law is going to bump local law every time.
And that's what's happened here.
Now, if the sheriff
has
to...
You believe that's the interpretation?
No. That is a fact.
Well, I know that, but, you know, I'm going to debate the point that it says in an office of the state or federal. You're not in her office when you walk in the door and you're in the lobby and you're in the tax office.
Oh, I agree with what you're saying.
You know, words mean what they mean. And either state law is written poorly here or somebody's interpreting it, and I'm going to charge this for their own good. This thing has been behind the scenes ever since we passed it. There's been somebody trying to shoot it down.
That's what bothers me.
And they've circumvented what the county commissioners voted unanimously, and if there needs to be a challenge, it needs to come from us through our attorney to the attorney general. It doesn't need to be private people interpreting it the way they want to interpret it and to trying to pacify a group of people, and they go on their own to try to shoot it down. And that's exactly what's happened here.
Mr. Sutton.
Yes, sir.
I am not trying to circumvent anybody. I'm tasked with enforcing the law. And if it means me getting a ruling from the Attorney General, as sheriff, I'm going to do that.
Should have gone through the attorney from our board to get the inquiry?
It didn't at the time.
Well, you're doing it on your own.
Well, I'm sheriff. If I go out and arrest somebody on something illegally, then I'm going to be sued. Of course, the county's going to be sued too. But we wanted to make sure that what we were doing were absolutely correct. And we have a person in the Attorney General's office that is law enforcement liaison that answers these questions for us. What the attorneys do, I have nothing to do with. But I certainly wasn't trying to circumvent the Board of Commissioners. If I had been, I certainly wouldn't have called Mr. Smith.
Well, you're real close with David, and I'm just going to go ahead and say that. Y'all talk a lot. There's five people on this board.
But that's not my duty.
There's five people.
Well, I got the memo from Clyde. I didn't get it from the sheriff.
I got what you say he sent, but there's so many ambiguous lines in there as to what the law is and how it can be interpreted. You can have one attorney general interpret it one way. You can have another interpret it another way. I don't know how the questions were posed to the attorney general. We should know that. Our attorney should know that. I mean, you can load a question a million ways.
And the Attorney General used to answer it the way you wanted it answered. Now, whether they still do that or not, I don't know.
Well,
what? Let me ask you this.
I certainly would have been more
community. What do you want this board to do?
You're going to throw it in my lap now, huh?
No, just for
all right. We passed an ordinance, 5-0.
Well, we repealed an ordinance.
Or repealed it. But in doing so, you create a law. Or you create something new that you couldn't do in the past. Is he saying that you can't carry, conceal carry, or open carry?
Yes, sir.
Period.
No weapons, period.
Okay. Well, see.
If we move it to the courtroom.
There you go.
Well, that's been my thought. I inquired today about her lease. I said, move her out in the parking lot. But I probably said it a little bit not as nice. But the point is, I inquired about her lease, and the lease is still valid. Okay? I question whether she's a federal employee, number one. I don't know that she gets a federal paycheck. She may. But now, I understand the rent's paid federal out of Washington. Now, we've done checked on that. But, you know, I'm just, this is not the way I see government as it should be run.
Well, I want you to understand that I only did what I had to do as sheriff to clarify this law.
Well, you didn't want it passed. You didn't want us to do it to start with. You
came
here.
That's what it looks like to me.
No offense.
That's exactly what
I'm hot over it. You stood right there and you told me in the back room in there, you don't know how this got started. You're the one that stood there and wanted us to all go through metal detectors, and I resented that everybody in this room would go through a metal detector just to pay their taxes. Then you wanted to have us ban everything. So I'm not happy the way. I don't do business this way. I don't do government this way.
Let me say.
I don't. Whether you agree with me or not.
Well,
wait a minute. Commissioner,
well, it looks like to me, Terry, you can't have it both ways. You are an elected official. You are an elected official. You either for concealed carry or you against it. Make up your mind.
Let me tell you something. I am a believer in the Second Amendment.
It sure don't show it.
My whole hand went on the Holy Bible to enforce the laws of the state of North Carolina, not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States. And the law is on the books. The Attorney General has said that's the law. And Mr. Lashley, where I believe in that law or not, I am going to enforce it. There's a lot of laws I disagree with on the books in the state and the federal government. But they are the law. And as sure my hand went on the Bible, and whether we like it or not, I'm going to enforce those laws. And I don't disagree. I mean, I don't agree with some of them. But I'm going to enforce those laws.
You don't enforce the laws in this building. Your stuff stops at the door.
No, sir, it don't.
Yes, it does.
Would you like to read the law? I'm serious. I'm not trying to argue with you.
Terry, the world of it. With all due respect, you know, do you believe that her office is walking in the hallway and by her not going in her office, going in the tax office? Do you think that qualifies for the statement of in an office of the state or federal government?
Once again, I'm trying to tell you, it don't matter what I think, it's what they say the law is, Mr. Sutton.
Did you pose that to who'd you talk to at the Attorney General's office?
Tim Britt talked with our liaison in the law enforcement liaison.
So we haven't talked to
him. Mr. Britt is not here. I can't get him here to tell you, but as soon as he talked to him, he called me immediately. And I immediately notified the county manager, county attorney, and Mr. Smith that we may have a big problem. And that's all I can do. But if the Attorney General says this is the law, then I'm going to enforce it.
But we have a right to challenge it. We have a right to challenge it. Attorney General's being challenged right now on voting rights.
I totally agree. But until it's challenged and ruled on, I have to follow the ruling and the law.
Well, I believe we could have allowed our whatever we passed to go through, and then if somebody wanted to take it to court, of course we're in court enough, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
Sheriff, is there a written copy of the opinion by
I will try to get a hold of Mr. Britt. His cell phone, no way, he's at Cedar Island on a hunting trip, but I will try to find out. I'll call the Attorney General's office myself, and if they sent one, they'll send me another.
Tim, anything else you won't.
It wasn't done right, I know that.
Can I please speak?
My personal opinion.
Please, sir.
I had 2 minutes.
Please, sir.
Okay.
having enough argument here. We don't want all everybody in the room arguing.
People should be able to debate.
You've had your opportunity at the beginning of the meeting.
No, sir.
Anything else? Sir, do you want me to remove you from this meeting? Please do not interrupt this board.
You break rules on everything else. Why you want to, why Sheriff, you want to be ruling them? You was locking people up, charging them with crimes and everything else.
Sheriff, will you remove this?
He ain't got two on leave.
I don't know.
But y'all ain't right.
I don't want out here. You don't need that problem.
I'm sorry,
all right, anything else on this issue, Tim? Bill?
No. Not on this issue.
You have something
else? Yeah, I do. Since we met last time, Commissioner Chair Smith and Vice Chair Bill and myself went with Craig Honeycutt and the Sheriff to the Alamance Community College breakfast, and we were bestowed a very, very nice award, and I think Craig's going to get the award, but I just wanted to point out all the different partnerships that I did not realize we had. I don't remember them all, but if we could just list, I know the Sheriff's Department.
It was
very nice, and Commissioner Chairman Smith accepted it on behalf of Alamance County. But we listed all the partnerships, and the community college has just been a really, really, it's been a great relationship. And EMS, the Sheriff's Department, certainly
DSS,
the
Health
funding,
Department.
There was much
Ag,
more.
Ag Extension.
The cars from the auto mechanics that the Sheriff's Department donated, I believe.
Right.
It just goes on and on. Yeah. So I was real proud to be there with y'all at the time. So I just wanted to make that point.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have one thing.
Yeah.
Wednesday, Piedmont Tribe Regional Council is meeting to dedicate the new building that we have just obligated ourselves to give money to. So it's at noon in Kernersville, and it's on the left side of the interstate on Highway 66. If anybody's interested, I will be there, because I am a liaison to the Piedmont Tribe Regional Council.
I went by there the other day. They've got this mobile bus out there, job. How, what does it take to get that to come here?
I have no idea. I can find out for you, because
yeah,
I'm
nice,
going
yeah.
Wednesday.
That's a nice building.
Yeah, it's a beautiful building inside, too.
It's across the street from Bishop McKinnis High School.
It is. So, just want to let everybody know, if anybody wants to go, I'm going.
Commissioners, have any other comments? Let me just raise one particular issue, and that is our Human Relations Council. It seems like I get a call about every week concerning the Human Relations Council. It seems it's a dysfunctional organization. There's too many people. I think it takes a 24-member board. I would like for the board, if it would, to just think about what we need to do to make this organization more functional. And hopefully we can come up with something. I think cutting the number of appointees to that board is one of the things that we need to do. And I think there are four people who are even going off of the board as of December 31. And they have not applied for reappointment, so their terms will be over. And if my count is correct, that leaves 9 active people on the board. So, and we have applications for about 5 or 6 people who have applied. So those 5, those can make their way on to the board here. But if each of us would just try to think of some way that we can make that that board a little more responsive to the public and to the county commissioners also. That's all I have.
Mr. Chair,
yes,
I have one more thing, and I'm not going to ask for any action on it, but I do want you to see what we've provided for you tonight.
Yeah, I have a
There's about a 17-page article that the Raleigh News and Observer ran Sunday on the front page, and they took it from the New York Times. And it's a very current article. It's titled "The Selling of Attention Deficit Disorder." And what it's about is a Duke professor emeritus who has been trying to legitimize the existence of attention deficit disorder, and he even started the attention deficit disorder clinic at Duke, or the study clinic at Duke on this very issue. He has got credentials, as on both sides. I'm sure there's people on both sides that have credentials, but he went to Harvard, University of Chicago, Oxford, and Stanford, and he was speaking at a conference in Washington this past fall in regards to this very issue. And the assumption in the article, the premise in a way, is that, well, he should be happy that it's the numbers, you know, the diagnosis and the recognition of the issue has never been greater. And they said he should be tickled to death. But then if you get into his comments, here's a direct quote. He says, "The numbers make it look like an epidemic." Well, it's not. It's preposterous. Dr. Connors, a psychologist and professor emeritus at Duke University, said in a subsequent interview, quote, "This is a concoction to justify the giving out of medication at unprecedented and unjustifiable levels." And what I would like to say is I hope I have dealt with the school system on this issue for over 2 years. I've been stonewalled every time I've approached them. I would like to see us sometime in the near future try to have a meeting with them to where we can not only discuss this issue but other issues. And I had suggested to Craig Honeycutt today that we have a meeting with them and possibly have on the agenda not only a discussion about this issue and what they say locally and what they believe locally, but something else, you know, school capital, you know, needs and so forth and so on. Just have a meeting with them and have several topics, but definitely let this be one of them.
Yeah.
Because North Carolina is rated, very few people know this, very few people know that North Carolina has the highest rate of attention deficit disorder in the United States. And then when you try to get into the schools and get into the people who diagnose it and write the prescriptions, this, all you get is a stonewall. We had to have our attorney ask the school system to provide us the documents that they claimed they didn't even have. But when we got them, it showed they do have a system of, in my opinion, steerage and recommending that you go to your doctor and get them to possibly prescribe ADH medicine to you. Okay, and they want you to believe, because they told me that the kids come to them already diagnosed. I don't believe that for a moment. I think the school system's heavily involved in it. This guy from Duke clearly says the school system's involved in it. And I'd like to try to get him to come to Burlington, and they can bring in maybe somebody on their side. I've been trying to call this guy all day long. And, you know, I want him, if it's good enough for the New York Times and good enough front page of Raw News and Observer, we ought to be able to have him come here and discuss the topic here. It's a worldwide concern that too many kids are being put on this medicine. And the deal is, they go from being put on it at elementary level, middle school level, high school level. Now the trend is they're going into adult life after having been on this medicine for 15 years, and they can't get off of it. They're committing suicide. It's becoming a drug of choice as an adult. They have to try to go out and find it on the black market because they can't do without it. But to bring this up in certain circles is just, it's almost taboo. They don't want to talk about it. But if you read this article, I think you'll see why I'm concerned about it. And we got a guy within 30 miles of here that I think we could probably learn a lot from. And I think our school system could. We all could. The doctors could. People say, you know, what county commissioners, why are they involved in this possibly? Well, here's why I think we're involved in it. I think, yeah, I'm involved in it. I'm a citizen. First, I'm an elected official. Second, I think it's our obligation as citizens and elected officials, if we see something that's out there that the public is being misused or something's being pushed on them that shouldn't be pushed on them or something that has not been brought to light that needs to be brought to light, I think it's our obligation to bring it out. And that's why I've been on this for 2 years and I'm not backing off. And that article Sunday, if you just read it, he's saying it's the biggest scam there's ever been.
I heard you talk about it. It looks interesting.
Yeah, he's. It's worth trying to have a dialogue about it because we're talking about little kids. We're talking about middle school, high school, and then later adults. They're giving them. I've had professionals in an open meeting tell me, I said, why do you think North Carolina's got the highest rate in the United States? Almost double what a lot of the other states have. We're right at 14% or something like that. She looked at me in an open meeting, and she's a practitioner. She's Medicaid approved and works with the kids. She says she didn't know that was a stat to start with. I said, yeah. I said, it's not from some far right-wing group. It's from the Center for Disease Control. Why do you think it's so prevalent out there in society? She looked at me. She didn't blink an eye in a public arena. She said, the schools push it to keep kids from being fidgety. Now, that's coming from a practitioner. And I think this guy right here would say, you're right. You're right on. But the school system, when you talk to the school system about it, they say, oh, no, we don't do it for that reason. We don't push anybody. We don't have a process. Well, when we got this out right here, when we had the county attorney, right, Clyde, wrote
yes.
for all the details about what were their processes, it came back full of letterheads, Alamance Burlington School System, questionnaires, Alamance Burlington School System, clearly steering people that, we have a little behavioral problem with your child. Why don't you take them to the doctor and see what they say? And then you go to the doctor. It's an automatic ADHD prescription. You say, that guy right there say, exactly, that's what's happening. He's saying it's not an epidemic. It's just, well, you've heard what I've said. So anyway, I hope that we can meet with them sometime. I don't care when it is, but put this on their agenda somehow. And let's talk about it. Let's get some frank discussion going. And you ask them how many are on it. They can't tell you. They won't tell you. They won't tell you the money flow involved. Yet when we got it, there's millions of dollars that flow in to the school system due to the numbers of children they have classified as exceptional children. There are children that need it, but I would dare say the majority of them don't need the medicine, the heavy-duty medicine. And this guy right here, has fought it for 50 years as far as studying it, way more than I have, way more than anybody in the school system has, way more than anybody on his board. He says it's the biggest scam in the world. And it's prescription, medicine people, it's doctors, school officials. He's tying all three of them in a link. Go read the article. And if y'all don't have it, you can pull it up. New York Times, Raleigh News and Observer, and it was titled The Selling of Attention Deficit Disorder. That title alone is a sin, considering that it's children that's involved.
Craig, you looking into this? You going to see what the board says, the other board?
We will get in touch with them and ask that this board is asked for a joint meeting and to discuss classroom size and facility issues, but also the ADHD. Yeah. Issue, so I'll let them be aware of that tomorrow.
We're supposed to have a photograph tonight.
I believe so.
What, Scott? Supposed to take a photograph.
Yeah. Everybody's wearing a tie. You look.
Is he ready?
They broke out in the grand.
All right. anything else to come before the board officially? Then, if not, Merry Christmas to everybody and.
We are.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
Seven.
All in favor?
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can